Let's begin with some basics. Could you please introduce yourself and what are you doing, what you're interested in?
My name is Travis McDermott. I am a systems administrator at a large company that you've likely heard of. Since my teenhood, I've been interested in the use of computer technology in order to infringe on our civil liberties. It's been an obsession and something that I've been very passionate about. So I've been researching it diligently ever since.
How are some of the ways that security can impact everyday people? I mean, some people may say, well, A, I don't have anything to hide, and B, even if I'm somewhat politically savvy as a political activist, I don't know enough about computers to know or to care. So try to answer those questions if you would, please.
So there's a really great quote by Edward Snowden, which goes, arguing that you don't care about privacy because you have nothing to hide is the equivalent of arguing that you don't care about First Amendment protected speech because you have nothing to say. And I feel that the way that the Constitution was framed puts in place a number of checks and balances, the most important of which is the power in the hands of the people. The people are at the very end and largest pool of the checks to make sure that government doesn't get out of line, that the power that we surrender to the government is made legitimate by the consent of the people. And when the consent of the people is no longer being served or regarded, then the government is considered illegitimate. And unfortunately, I feel that we've gotten to a place through our policies at this point that people's interests are no longer represented in our government. And the strongest, most powerful tool that they have for oppression against us is technology because of our dependence on it. Because it's so ubiquitous and because it's so empowering, the government can stay one step ahead of any attempt to instill people's liberties. For people to have and retain that power. It allows the power to be concentrated at the top of the hierarchy and for them to act with impunity outside of the interests of the general public. And Glenn Greenwald actually said it best, when I know everything about you, what you're planning, who you're talking about, what you're talking about, what your fears are, what your habits are, what you do from day to day, and you know nothing about me, it gives me a great deal of power over you. I can proceed to manipulate you in ways that you don't even know. I can influence your decisions. I can prevent you from making certain actions that would not be in my interests. And that's the point that we've gotten to.
Going to the technology aspect, if I'm a Luddite activist who doesn't know anything about technology, how would what you're talking about affect me in my day-to-day political activism when I am challenging powers that be?
So there are a number of technologies that are used against activists. Unfortunately, we've been milled into equating First Amendment protected speech with harmful activities. Often people consider a protest almost a form of low-level terrorism. And especially those who are tasked with enforcing the law view it that way. So if you are engaging in those activities, you could be targeted. And I have evidence that shows that even at the local level, the Chicago police have targeted protesters in the city.
Could you explain some of the evidence and some ways in which the police, the Chicago Police Department, are doing this?
So here's an example. This is a couple, well, this is one of the individuals that infiltrated the NATO 3.
Mm-hmm.
These are some people who were in Chicago protesting NATO assembly here. And what happened is that they were staying at a certain individual's residence. The Chicago police were able to glean enough information to figure out where they were staying, and then they sent infiltrators into the group in order to dismantle their structure and prevent them from proceeding with First Amendment activities. The way that they did this was by getting the individuals to drunkenly talk about making Molotov cocktails. And they brought in, they actually facilitated and encouraged the purchase of gasoline, and there was brewing equipment in the house where they were staying. And essentially, to some, it seems a lot like entrapment, as though these individuals wouldn't have otherwise come to those conclusions or started to even think at a more radical level if the Chicago police hadn't encouraged that activity in the first place. And what's startling about this, I think, is that this is the sort of activity that we typically attribute to a higher intelligence community entities like the FBI, the CIA. And we know, and we have known since the 70s, that the CIA was engaging in these sorts of activities. But the fact that it's gotten down to this level now seems to imply that the Chicago police are acting almost as an extension of the intelligence community.
So the police are using the methods to infiltrate on legitimate protected political activity and speech, organizing, activism, that sort of thing, using that knowledge against them to effectively destroy those activities. And this is one example of that. Is that fair to say?
Yes. And this is another document. This is a First Amendment worksheet. This is what the Chicago police submit in order to get the legal justification to proceed with that activity. And it establishes their grounds for suspicion, and then it gets signed off on by the chief of police and the mayor and so on and so forth. We have recently gotten another document that shows that about 1 year ago, there was one of these First Amendment forms submitted in order to survey the Black Lives Matter movement and some other groups. And this is one of the pages from the document which shows a number of the groups that they were targeting in Chicago. There was also an incident during Brown Friday, which was the Black Lives Matter movement in honor of
Mike Brown.
And what happened was that they had deployed some technology called a stingray, which mimics a cell phone tower, and your cell phone connects to it before connecting to your actual carrier network. So everything that you say then goes through their fake cell tower, and they can hear it and view it if it's text messages. And there was a recording that somebody caught just through over-the-air open frequencies of a police officer requesting access to an organizer's cell phone, and he called out to the unit that deploys these things regularly.
What is the extent to which these stingrays would be able to find out about you and your cell phone? You mentioned phone calls, you mentioned texts.
Mm-hmm.
Is that it? Is there more?
So the primary use is to catch what's called your IMSI, that's IMSI. And it's a unique identifier that your phone broadcasts in order to essentially establish with your cell tower that you're authorized to use their network. However, because it is a unique number that's assigned to your phone, if a malicious actor, like the Chicago police, use a stingray to capture it, they can then take that unique identifier, query it, ask for the subscriber from the telecom provider, and they have your identity. That is the main reason that they're deploying these, is to find out who is attending the protests. But then they do have the capabilities to also tap into the communications.
Following up on this telecom company response to, I've got your identifier, let me call AT&T and Verizon to find out about that, and find out who you are. What reasons would the companies have to comply? You would figure there should be a breach of privacy regarding, you know, their customers, and they shouldn't, you know, just hand it off without, you know, a subpoena or some judge's order or something.
Mm-hmm.
But are they just doing this flippantly? Are they actually heeding, you know, valid procedure and constitutional reasons for abiding by this? What role did the telecom companies play in this?
So the problem is that constitutionality and legality are not the same thing.
Okay.
There are very serious constitutional implications to these activities. However, because of the way that that the amendments were written, there's a lot of wiggle room in order for the powers that be to dispute that what they're doing is within the confines of what's outlined by the Constitution, because it was written at a time when these technologies didn't exist. So on the legal side, they are using subpoenas in order to get the information, or on the higher levels of government, they may use a FISA ruling, or an NSA letter is another document that they use in order to get this. But essentially what they're doing is threatening the existence of the telecoms with these powers that they have, that they've structured this legal framework around, and saying if you don't comply, bad things will happen to you and your establishment.
What's the likelihood that those who are not engaging in these kind of open political activities are also being targeted? I mean, you would figure that, yes, these are activists who are out in the streets and they're trying to get attention.
Mm-hmm.
So one could skeptically say they're asking for it. But if I'm John Q. Public, somewhat apolitical, am I at risk?
Well, the way that programs like the NSA's bulk collection program, for example, the way that those work, is that they're sweeping up all information regardless of whether that person is a potential threat or not. And their argument is that they only need a subpoena when they're about to look at it. So the mere collection of data itself is not an infringement on civil liberties and doesn't warrant having any authority blessed upon them do this. The way that that's structured is that they can go two hops away from their target. So if you're targeted, everyone that you have ever spoken with electronically that they've logged is now a target. But more than that, each one of those individuals that you've associated with, everyone that they have also associated with is also able to be targeted.
And that's what's meant by two hops. You're traveling from one group to another group. Except that, as I understand it, the number of people that are potentially encompassed in that sphere could be, I mean, if you say, for the sake of argument, have 100 Facebook friends.
Mm-hmm.
So how many people is that for two hops away among the spheres of each of those Facebook friends? How many friends do each of them have?
Yes.
What are the numbers here?
You would really have to model it out, which I haven't done. However, it's exponential growth. With each hop that you get away, you expand your pool significantly.
Yeah.
To the extent that it gives them broad reaching powers to surveil people to the point that it's almost anyone.
And it sounds like that it's, and that kind of follows up on the point you raised, that even if you are apolitical, you are nonetheless close enough that you are apt to be caught in this digital dragnet. Is that fair to say?
Absolutely.
Okay. Let's focus back on the Chicago aspects of all of this. Everyone knows about the National Security Agency and the Edward Snowden leaks and the impacts that has had, which have brought some measure of certainly debate, arguably some kind of policy reform, but it's still nonetheless, as we see here, happening in Chicago. What are some other examples about that?
The funny thing about the sort of Chicago dragnet, if you will, is that it isn't just limited to the Chicago police either. The Chicago police have a data sharing policy in which they provide access to this information, everything that they collect, to federal agencies through what they call fusion centers. So all of the camera footage, all of the license plate data that they're collecting, all of the cell phone data that they're collecting, all gets put into central databases, which are then able to be looked up by groups like the FBI, CIA, NSA, and branches of those intelligence community apparatus that you've never even heard of.
How do we know that this is even happening? Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously it's not the kind of thing that the Chicago Police Department is going to post on their website.
Mm-hmm.
So how do we know that they're doing this?
So I'd like to frame this in the context of the stingrays.
Okay.
Because that's one of the most telling cases for how this has all been revealed. Stingrays, the way that they are utilized is that the FBI has control over stingrays use by local law enforcement. And there's one company that manufactures the actual stingray brand hardware. Now, mind you, Stingray is, just as I said, a brand of an MZ catcher. The first case that came out about this was an individual who was living off the grid, and he was committing insurance fraud, or tax fraud, rather.
Mm-hmm.
And they ended up catching him by the location of his cell phone using one of these things. Now, regardless of the implications of whether that's morally just or not, when he went to court, they were so secretive about the mere existence of stingrays that the individuals working on the case weren't even allowed to name it by name. And that has been a constant theme in many cases regarding this. Certain cases across the country have been thrown out of court altogether just to prevent the knowledge of the technology that they were using. And so this individual, while he was in prison, was requesting the documents using the Freedom of Information Act, going through his lawyer, having his lawyer look up all of the terms that he was finding on Google and getting public information about it. And he painstakingly dug through all of the material that he got until he found that keyword stingray. And from there, he ended up discovering what it was. Locally, there's an activist by the name of Freddie Martinez, who once that information became available, and once the story broke that this exists and it's being used, he immediately jumped on the case and started submitting Freedom of Information requests for Chicago's use of them. And he has had to repeatedly sue the city in order to get them to comply with his FOIA requests. And he's gotten on the order of thousands of pages, or maybe hundreds, I'd have to check that number, but at least hundreds of pages of documents that detail how many stingrays the Chicago police has, what funds are being used in order to acquire them, because of the funding source, what activities they're allowed to be used to catch, and so on and so forth.
Do we have any details regarding the scale of that? I mean, how many stingrays are there that are being used? Are we still waiting for the numbers about that to pan out?
No, and I'm trying to recall from memory. I think it's 5, but it's at least 3.
Okay.
I would have to look up the specific document, but they're all public.
And speaking of the public, the Chicago City Council. To what extent do, I don't know if you know this, but to what extent do the City Council, aldermen and staff, know that this is happening under their name, under their budget, maybe with their approval, even if somewhat tacit?
Mm-hmm.
How does the local government fit into all of this?
So, because of the way that it's structured, the whole organization of any of this is shrouded in secrecy. It is meant to be kept from the public. So it's difficult to speculate on that, which I fear it would come down to just that, speculation. But at least the upper echelons of the Chicago police know about it, and those that they work with within the FBI locally.
So you would figure that, I mean, hearing about this, I'm very tempted to just call my alderman's office and say, look what's happening. And they could probably look up some of this information, or if anyone can, to let them know. Would you advise that as far as an approach that someone watching or listening to this should do?
Sure, yeah, absolutely. So there are a couple of different ways that we can combat this. One is through policy making.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, the best way to approach that is around landmark decisions that impact it. So you would want to strategically place those calls at a time when it would most suit your narrative. So when you would be able to actually impact change. So watching what's happening locally and nationally with stingrays is important. To make sure that you time that and you're not just coming out of left field talking about stingrays when your alderman probably has no idea what the context is in the first place.
Right.
Organizing in order to make it an issue that is on the forefront of their minds and that they would feel threatened, their election would feel threatened by, is important. And then technologically is the other way. There are a lot of technical ways that you can prevent this sort of surveillance.
Mm-hmm. And suppose I'm not terribly technically savvy.
Mm-hmm.
How would I learn? How would I learn more? What are some of the things I could do? Or is there some, like, for lack of a better word, a dummy's guide to digital security? Anything like that that I could just go to, go to a bookstore to get? Something like that?
Sure. Well, so I put on a number of classes in order to better conceptualize this for people and to make it approachable and sort of wade through the jargon and the confusion about the technology so that people can better understand what exactly is the threat and how to circumvent it. I call it OpSec, or operational security. And you can find out more about that by emailing me. It's dissident@revolt.net. And then there's also some pretty simple ways that you can at least start to take a stand. Fortunately, with the brilliance of volunteer programmers, we have the technology available to us now on Android and iOS, the Apple platform, to get basic protections against this. The programs that are the apps that you can download are published by a group called Whisper Systems, and on iOS it's called Signal, and on Android there are two apps that you need to get. One of them is Redphone, which protects your calls, and the other is called TenseSecure. which protects your text messages.
1 minute text secure?
Yep.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Going back for a moment to the kind of local dimensions about this, one thing that has come to my mind in recent months regarding the security and the knowledge therein are the protests involving a black ops site in the Chicago police have maintained called Holman Square. So that was revealed in a rather explosive article in the Guardian newspaper. To my mind, what I can tell from the Chicago media, it was all but disavowed, basically parodying whatever the press release was that the Chicago police had said, at least acknowledging it, saying whatever bad-mouthing the police said, and then it was utterly dropped. I didn't see any follow-up coverage from the Chicago media after like a day or so.
Yeah.
So how does that Holman Square revelation fit into this whole apparatus regarding local security, digital surveillance, and the like?
I'm glad you mentioned it, because many of the entities that are tasked with deploying this hardware, this equipment, actually operate out of Holman Square.
Mm-hmm.
They are the special operations branch of the Chicago Police. And so that's most likely where a lot of the capabilities lie. And I have some experience with that, specifically as the lead organizer against Holman Square. The problem with the media coverage about it is that it seems like it's not conducive to the narrative of many local media outlets to cover it in a critical way. And they have very much taken the side of the Chicago police and their official talking points in order to try and minimize people's perception and frame it within the context that they're just using this to get the bad guys. The issue is that this is a phenomenon in logical biases that we're all susceptible to that is being exploited here. It's the belief that everything is black and white. There are good guys and there are bad guys, and the cops are the good guys and they're getting the bad guys. But there's a very spotted history in Holman Square, both with the abuse of detainees, as well as with the corruption of the officers working out there. There were a number of cases in the early aughts where there were cops that were confiscating cocaine and other drugs from people, and then turning around and planting it on suspects in order to impose what their personal agendas were. And those individuals did end up going to court. It was revealed. This is all a matter of fact. And when you have these systems in which you're asked to put blind faith into your trust of authority, those systems are ripe for abuse by the people who run them.
The old line from Juvenal applies, quis custodius ipsos custodit, who watches the watchers.
Mm-hmm.
This is probably a classic. Talking more broadly about this, the idea about how the idea of digital surveillance kind of represents a power struggle. How they watch you and know your details, but yet you don't have details of what they're doing and how that can impact you. And it seems like that the measure of following through on a kind of better hygiene regarding your digital activities when it comes to security, it kind of represents a way to help to try to imbalance or restore that power struggle to a point where you can help to gain a little bit of that edge that you lost.
Mm-hmm.
Elaborate on that, if you would, please, regarding the power involved or the struggle for power involved with these technologies and these efforts.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, like I said earlier, I feel that the most important part of accountability within government is the power of the people to keep them in check when they're no longer serving our best interests.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a line out of George Orwell's 1984 that I really like that mentions something to the effect of it wasn't direct oppression that made this regime seem so evil. And I'm paraphrasing.
Mm-hmm.
But it was the emptiness, the listlessness of modern life. And so we fail to recognize often the ways in which we're oppressed, because to us, to the way that we've been taught about oppression, it takes only the form of physical violence. Oppression means that people are being killed. But oppression takes so many different forms other than that. Oppression can be financial oppression, which is one of the main ways that people are kept small and made to feel helpless against authority today. And because we don't, and that's one of the most important impacts too, is the way that we're impacted financially by the powers that be.
I could see a problem here where, playing this out, say that you've got some bombshell revelation regarding the Chicago police that you happen to discover or digitally decipher by digital means.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, I mean, the example of the Holman Square example was a part of this. It got a lot of attention for a couple of days. There were subsequent protests, and then very little activity. I imagine most people, when they see this narrative, even when they hear about the necessary idea regarding surveillance and protecting yourself these days, on the digital level where most people now live, they may feel disempowered. They feel like, well, they tried and it didn't work, so why should I bother? How do you respond when you hear that kind of disempowering narrative? What's your response?
So Holman Square isn't over. Just because you're not reading about it in the news doesn't mean that nothing's happening. The most recent activity that I've heard of on it, I've since passed it off to another individual who's more capable and more able at this point to designate the time that's necessary to see our objectives come to fruition. But the most recent activity that I've heard from that is that the alderman has started to take a stand against it and call for the closure of the facility. I feel that the most powerful way that you can impact that through activism is through raising awareness and keeping people's focus on the fact that it is corrosive to a healthy democracy to have these completely shadowy entities working without any sort of external verifiability, no accountability whatsoever. And so the fight is still going, and it has been going. Holman Square was known about long before the most recent revelations in The Guardian. There's a gentleman, Mr. Siska. He's a lawyer that led The Guardian to Holman Square when they were here investigating some malfeasance by an officer in that site. So, he's been on his soapbox about this facility for years. So the media attention definitely helps, but in order to actually impact change, the best thing that we can do is to research the issue, get as many details as we can about it, and certain names will start to spring up over and over. In your research, reach out to those people. Their email addresses are available online.
Focusing for a moment back on the media issue, actually from where I'm sitting, my line of sight, I can actually see the peacock of the NBC tower.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of appropriate that we're talking about this. If the local media were to even just take more attention to the issue, never mind being somewhat critical about it, although I think that would be helpful here, There were like, if say, you know, the Chicago Tribune, the Chicago Sun-Times, the main five local television stations, maybe a handful of radio stations, all were to be suddenly talking about this every day, nonstop, or at least make it part of their narrative, I would imagine that with that increased public awareness, people would be forced to respond, and we would see some maybe changes, maybe reforms, but something in something positive.
Yeah.
You would think, though, but the problem, though, is that I see that these local media sources using the police as a source for a lot of coverage, especially where the whole line, if it bleeds, it leads. They don't want to irk that. They don't want to jeopardize that. And they don't want a source of ready stories when news days are slow, or even when news days aren't slow. They've still got to fill up that half hour of TV time with local news or that newspaper every day. And so they don't want to jeopardize that. So what would be some ways, if at all possible, to try to overcome that kind of disparity? Anything?
So I think that the issues are being talked about by alternative media outlets. You can find the stories and find those who are still taking action on them by doing your own independent research. And unfortunately, I think that we've gotten to a point now where, like you said, regardless of the ethical implications of the stories, the media outlets and those who work for them and those who work for the government are always going to put their own interests in priority to the interests of the people at large. One perfect example of this is the Black Lives Matter actions. One of the reasons that we have such a problem is because of people's perception. When you're working within an institution like the Chicago Police that only sees the violence and only sees the negative sides of the neighborhoods that they're enforced with, or that they're trying to protect, they tend to get a very negative view on the people that they're tasked with protecting, and they start to see them as the enemy. And there are other instances of this, like regulatory capture. It's important to remember people's psychology and the way that they view things, and how that is going to impact the story that you end up getting.
Elaborate a bit more on what you mean by people's psychology, individual psychology. What do you mean by that?
So, for example, the regulatory capture is a perfect illustration of this. Regulatory capture is when individuals who are tasked with holding a group accountable know people way too well and are way too friendly with those people. And as a result, they're unable to make unbiased, objective decisions about issues that would hold those individuals accountable. There is a case where right after 2008 and the financial crisis, the Federal Reserve of New York was making a lot of very suspicious deals on the eve of holidays that it seemed like was structured specifically to prevent accountability. And there was an individual that was working for them at that time that tried to work within the structure of their branch in order to bring this to light and to raise outcry about it and hold them accountable and do their job in preventing this deal from going through. But because they interacted with these individuals from these banks so regularly, and they thought of them almost as friends at worst, and at best, somebody to be intimidated by or afraid of, they didn't end up making the right decision to prevent policies from moving forward that were not in the public interest.
In the face of what might seem to be overwhelming institutional apparatuses that are hard to try to not only defeat, but just even budge, to just, you know, just do your job, just don't surveil us. That isn't too much to ask. It would seem that people are might be overwhelmed by this. It's just one, I'm just one person, I can't do very much about this. Why would I bother? How would you respond to that line of thinking? Why should I bother?
It's important to remember that the institutions that hold power are going to do everything that they can to try and maintain that power structure. Even during the American Revolution, the idea of democracy was very much fought against by the financial interests of the time, because it didn't suit their bottom line. So we've somehow been led to believe that democracy was good, but then also that everyone was on board and we just went forward and the whole nation fought together for a common interest. In reality, that's never how it happens. There's always going to be a split and a very well-resourced group that's going to be opposing your actions when you're trying to go up against them. So if you look historically at the battles that have been won for the rights of the people, you'll see that during those times, it wasn't so black and white like we like to imagine it now. There was opposition. It was a difficult fight. But in the end, we enjoy a lot of our liberties because of these struggles. So the opposition that you get, you should perceive as a challenge and not a barrier.
And what do you foresee as far as the future of all these struggles? Do you think that ultimately, for lack of a better word, you think you will prevail against these mighty forces, despite the fact that they may seem to have the world and a half at their beck and call? Resources, money, institutional security, public awareness. That's a lot to have to try to overcome. But nonetheless, as history has shown in the past, that sometimes doesn't matter to a whole lot if you don't have that moral authority.
Yeah.
Is that well, do you think that will be the case here?
Absolutely, and I feel that one of the lies that we believe, or the fallacies that we believe, when we hear about things like the NSA surveillance, for example, it gives us the impression that we're up against gods, that they have god powers, and that they absolutely can't be stopped. The way that I structure my OpSec courses talks exactly about where specifically their powers end, and what they are able to see, what they're not able to see, and how to stay within that boundary of blinding the surveillance state.
If it's all right with you, can you give an example of one way in which their powers end? It'd be nice to know. It's just like, okay, what can they do?
Sure.
Maybe that might be a little bit of room for me to try to expand that freedom.
Absolutely. So there is some information. Let me see if I can pull it up. Did I put it in this? Yeah. We have gotten, around December of 2013, there was another leak of documents which showed that encryption, certain types of encryption, were unable to be gathered by the NSA. And encryption, just to give you a little bit of background, is essentially scrambling the data so that only the intended recipient can see it. So the way that I like to conceptualize this is that if I want to share a secret with you, say through the mail, but I don't trust that the post office is going to respect my privacy, I could put it inside of a tamper-evident box and put a lock on it. And if anybody that I want to communicate with like this, I can give these locks to, and they can send me a private message and put one of the locks on it, I'm the only one who has the key to those locks. Therefore, as long as I hold on to those keys and protect those keys, anybody who handles the package in transit to me would not be able to read the contents of the messages that were put inside that box. And that's a lot of what encryption does, except instead of physical locks and keys, it's math. And in practice, you don't even have to think about the math. You just have to know how to use the locks. So there are a number of technologies, such as PGP is one of them, which can be a little bit daunting.
Pretty good privacy.
Good privacy is the technology that's used to protect emails. There is the aforementioned apps that you can get in order to protect your communications on your phone. On both Android and iOS, you can now encrypt the contents of your phone. However, there are a lot of caveats to this, such as I just mentioned encrypting your actual cell phone. That will only work when your cell phone is turned off. If you are pulled over by the Chicago police and taken into their custody, and your cell phone is turned on but encrypted, they can still plug it into a device which will dump all of the contents of your cell phone, including all of your text messages, all of your contacts, everything that you've done on the phone. And we pretty much live in our phones now. Our location, everything that we do is logged on these phones. The more you try to protect, the more you have to worry about and consider when you're implementing these technologies. So this is where the idea of threat modeling comes in. If you want to put an end to the Stingray use, for example, a super simple way to do it is just turn your cell phone off. When you go out to protests, it won't be broadcasting to the towers. They won't pick up your IMSI. They won't be able to tell that you're even there. If you have something that you want to share in confidence with someone, make sure that you go physically to a location with them. Leave your cell phones at home, and organize it in a way that involves no electronics. And consider your every electronic transaction that you do to be an asset that you may need to protect. Then knowing how you need to protect those is where the sort of cat-mouse game comes into play. That's where the more things you feel you need to protect in order to protect yourself against the perceived threats, the more you're going to have to do in order to protect those things.
You've been teaching courses about this, mm-hmm. and have been sharing the knowledge about this with, I presume, everyday people, and probably also groups of political activists. Mm-hmm. What is your feeling regarding the receptivity of that message? Are they grateful for it? Do you feel like they just listen and then don't take your message to heart? What's been the response, in your opinion?
Everyone who's attended my courses has left glowing. People, the way that I explain things is in a very easy to understand way. I relate a lot of concepts that are difficult to understand if you're reading the Wikipedia page about it. I explain them through analogies, like I did with the padlock analogy,
right,
in order for people to better understand how it works before they try making it work.
That could be a project, maybe creating a wiki of easy-to-understand security ideas.
Yeah, that's the idea of revolt.net. Unfortunately, I'm in the middle of a transition with that website right now, so it's going to be revised eventually, and I'll definitely have up what I'm calling the arsenal, which is how to protect yourself using the tools that are available. There's also a really great website called prismbreak.org. That's PRISM-break, BREAK.org.
A reference, no doubt, to the PRISM metadata collector that the NSA uses in which the Edward Snowden revelations leaked.
Correct. And that gives you a long list of all of the technologies that have sort of been vetted by the community. And what I mean by that is that there are certain ways that you can know how to trust software without being a programmer. For example, there are entire operating systems, like Windows is an operating system, Mac is an operating system. There's a third option that people usually don't hear about called Linux, which is designed and developed and maintained entirely by volunteers. And you can get it for free, you download it for free, you can try it out without even hurting your computer. You don't have to install it to find out whether you like it or not. And one of the major benefits of that is that through practice, they've made sure that all of the source code, that all of the programs that have gone into this operating system are available for programmers to read. What that means is that even if you aren't a programmer, you benefit from this system because there are programmers looking through the code, making sure that there aren't any backdoors, making sure that the software that you're using to secure your phone communications isn't itself being used for surveillance on them.
Following locally on that point, when it comes to, trustworthiness on security and the technology issues in Chicago, the naive question might be, who can I trust for these sorts of things? How would you answer that?
So my security model is trust but verify. I had mentioned my position as a technologist earlier in my occupation. I would prefer that people don't use that to take everything I say as gospel, that it's written in stone and it must be correct. My security model is trust but verify. Use the resources at your disposal to learn about the technology that's available to you, but then verify it on your own. Research, look up forums, take everybody's opinion into account and weigh your different options in order to determine what's suitable for you.
Do we know anything about what the Chicago police and local law enforcement thinks about all of this technology regarding protection and encryption? I mean, have they said anything about this? Do we have any leaked documents? Or do they just not care? Or are they, you know, silently gritting their teeth in behind closed doors and swearing up a storm with no one to hear? Do we know anything what they're thinking about all of this?
Unfortunately, I don't think that it's ubiquitous enough to be on the radar yet. This is sheer speculation. Obviously they wouldn't be happy about it. They wouldn't come to an OpSec and volunteer information about their operations in order to facilitate people circumventing them.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think that enough people are aware of the basic protections that they can use to make it effective yet. And that's what I'm trying to fix.
What do you think would take to reach a kind of critical mass threshold where, you know, the Chicago police would give a care? What do you think it would take to reach that level of where they're coming to ask you questions or coming to your courses to try to infiltrate you because they're realizing that their communications that they thought they would have are no longer encrypted?
I think that what my target demographic is, the most potent group for me to reach, are the organizers, because they're the ones that the opposition is targeting. So the people that are actually putting together the protests and leading them are going to be the ones that are most at risk for surveillance. I just realized that the NSA emblem probably showed up on my shirt, so just so that you know that I'm not supporting the NSA by wearing it. So those are the individuals that I feel are most important to reach this message with. Mm-hmm. However, everyone who uses the basic protections adds to the overall cause. Mm-hmm. What I mean by that is one of the reasons that these technologies exist, that there's this massive dragnet surveillance going on, is because nobody's using basic protections to secure themselves. So we have bulk collection of plain in the clear communication that's all being saved as it goes through our carriers' networks. And then at any moment, if the NSA or what have you, any of them, wants to read the contents, the NSA, FBI, CPD in some cases, they can go to the backlog of data that they have collected over the course of the time that they've been collecting it, and retroactively read the information in order to find snippets that suit their narrative in order to take you down. When we start using encryption, then the communications in transit cannot be read. In order to circumvent that, in order for any law enforcement agency to then be able to read the contents, they would need the keys that I talked about earlier, which reside on the devices themselves. If you're using email encryption, the keys are going to be on your computer. If you're using text secure and red phone or signal, then the keys are going to reside on your cell phone. So they would have to hack into your cell phone in order to get that information. So the level of sophistication required by the Chicago police then increases by orders of magnitude, and they are probably not going to have the budget or the resources at their disposal, at least not immediately, in order to get that. And if they do, it's still going to be a pain. So even by using this technology, every additional person who does helps everyone who doesn't.
That there's a similar... is there anything that you feel you should mention in the time we have here and in the medium here that you feel like should be discussed or mentioned or highlighted that we haven't talked about?
Well, I think that we've pretty well covered a lot of the topics. I would like to mention that from my personal view, in working with activists inside of Chicago, I have unfortunately hit a lot of barriers with people based on trust. And if there's any takeaway here, I want it to be that I'm not trying to convince people to trust me to use software. I'm trying to provide resources to people so that they can empower themselves, so that they know how to trust and how to verify their communications, regardless of any entity or any individual's opinion about whether it's secure or not. I want to teach people how to be empowered, and in order to do that, you have to be the one who has control over your own security.